Morning, everyone. Welcome to Harmony today. I wish that this sanctuary behind me was filled with all of you, but since we can't be together physically, I'm glad that we can still be together in spirit as we gather together to worship God and to receive from Him today what He has for us. I want to pass along greetings to Dick, who's celebrating his 90th birthday this past Friday. Congratulations, Dick. Hope you had a very wonderful and special birthday. I know there's been some other birthdays as well, but that one is certainly a significant milestone. Today we have Val and Rob leading us in worship, and then I'll be coming back in a few minutes to talk about the final one of our character traits of a follower of Jesus. Today we're going to be looking at the trait of love. And so I hope you'll stick around and join me for that in just a few minutes. Right now, Rob and Val, won't you lead us in some singing?
Good morning, church. As you can see, we're in the sanctuary. It's empty, but it's full of love. We can't wait to worship with you soon, COVID permitting. Today we're talking about love, and a quick search of the Bible shows over 108 verses about love. Love is patient, love is kind, from Corinthians, do everything in love. From Psalm 143, let the morning bring me word of your unfailing love, from Colossians, and over these virtues put on love. From Proverbs, let love and faithfulness never leave you, and so on. Obviously the Bible is full of love and God's love for us. Isn't it nice that we serve a God that loves us? Let's pray. Lord, thank you for love. Thank you that we can come together on this online format and still share in the worship of you and your word. Let's worship together. Amen.
Your way among us, we welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. Darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. Fear, you lost your hold on me.
Louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
Sing a little louder. beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you our Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus.
You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now?
What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Thank you, Val and Rob, for leading us in worship today. I trust that you were able to enter right in and sing along with those songs wherever you're watching from. Right now, before we open God's Word together, I would invite you to bow your head and heart in prayer. Our loving God, we acknowledge you as our God, as a God who loves us no matter what, who promises to stay with us for the long haul, to see us through, never to leave us, never to abandon us. And God, in the midst of the days we're living in right now, we so need that, and we thank you for the assurance we have of your presence in our lives. God, we thank you for your love for us, that it's unconditional and enduring. God, we thank you for your word, your love letter to us. The pages within this book, it contains so much about what you think of us and all that you desire for us. God, it's our desire to listen now to your Spirit, that you might have the freedom to speak to us the message that we need to hear today. And God, then, by your grace, enable us to take action upon what we hear, and to go out from the place that we're listening to this and to be different, to be light in a dark world. We pray this in the name of Jesus, whom we love. Amen. Well, as I mentioned at the beginning of the service, today we are concluding our summer series. Can you believe summer is over? It looks like fall is just around the corner. School is about to start back up, and I know some of you that's a terrible thing, and others of you perhaps you're looking forward to that. We need to be in prayer for our teachers and our students as they head back to school in the midst of what's going to be a very different kind of year for them. But as we conclude this summer series, in which we've been looking at various traits that are true of a follower of Jesus Christ, the character traits that define us, we come to this final character trait today. Although I could go on, I think all year, in terms of listing other character traits that are important, this is probably the most important. And so today we're going to talk about love. It's estimated that over 100 million love songs have been recorded. 100 million. That's a pretty long playlist. In fact, about 64% of the songs recorded in any year are love songs. I'm sure that if we were doing this by Zoom or somehow we had a way of interacting with each other right now, you could probably sing us a portion of some of your favorite love songs. We all know them. But I thought I'd start today just by sharing a few lyrics with you from a few singers. James Arthur sings, "I'm so in love with you, and I hope you know. Darling, your love is more than worth its weight in gold. We've come so far, my dear. Look how we've grown, and I want to stay with you until we're gray and old. Just say you won't let go." Isn't that sweet? Then there's Enrique Iglesias, who sings these lyrics. He says, "You can run, you can hide, but you can't escape my love." That's not quite so sweet. That's actually a little creepy when you think about it. The Backstreet Boys sang, "I don't care who you are, where you're from, what you did, as long as you love me." That's actually kind of sad, but terribly revealing. There's probably many that can identify with those words, because we all just want to be loved. As we look at this passage today that I've selected for us, and it's actually two today, we're going to be looking at Colossians chapter 3 and then 1 John chapter 4, and you can put your thumb in both of those right now if you're going to read along with us. But as we look at them and talk about love, I have three main points for us today with regards to the reason that this character trait is the most important. And I want to begin by talking about the importance of love. Listen to Colossians chapter 3. I'm reading from the New Living Translation, and I'm going to start reading about verse 12. It says, "Since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others." And then this verse, "Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony." Again, you might want to underline that verse in your Bible. It's another verse that has the word harmony in it, and we've been highlighting those as we have been teaching over the past year. But there's another verse here that talks about perfect harmony. And it says that perfect harmony comes when all these qualities, all the character traits we've been talking about really, are bound together in love. I believe the Message refers and says to that over all these other things, wear love. It's your everyday all-purpose garment. Love is that thing that you wear every day. So on top of all the other character traits we've been talking about, in fact, if you boil them all down to their essence, you come to this trait of love. Love is so central to who God is that it's our primary test of our relationship with Him. The book of 1 John really is a letter about love. I encourage you to spend some time in the coming week reading and meditating in the book of 1 John. You'll find there's so much here about love. But I want to read to you a portion of scripture from 1 John chapter 4 that really talks about love. And I'm going to let it explain itself because it's so rich just in the way that it's been written here. John writes this: "Dear friends, let us continue to love one another, for love comes from God. Anyone who loves is a child of God and knows God. But anyone who does not love does not know God, for God is love. God showed how much He loved us by sending His one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through Him. This is real love. Not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. Dear friends, since God loved us that much, we surely ought to love each other. No one has ever seen God, but if we love each other, God lives in us, and His love is brought to full expression in us. And God has given us His Spirit as proof that we live in Him and He is in us. Furthermore, we have seen with our own eyes and now testify that the Father sent His Son to be the Savior of the world. All who confess that Jesus is the Son of God have God living in them, and they live in God. We know how much God loves us, and we have put our trust in His love. God is love, and all who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. And as we live in God, our love grows more perfect. So we will not be afraid on the day of judgment, but we can face Him with confidence because we live like Jesus here in this world. Such love has no fear, because perfect love expels all fear. If we are afraid, it's for fear of punishment. And this shows that we have not fully experienced His perfect love. We love each other because He loved us first. If someone says, I love God, but hates a Christian brother or sister, that person is a liar. For if we don't love the people we can see, how can we love God whom we cannot see? And He has given us this command: those who love God must also love their Christian brothers and sisters." You see, love is all important. It's so important that it defines our relationship with God. If we do not love, then we don't belong to God. We haven't experienced God's love for us. In Mark chapter 12, Jesus is asked, what is the most important thing to God? What matters the most to God? And to summarize, He replies, two things equally important: love God, love others. The two commands are alike. You need both of them in your life. Love God, love others. And that's actually pointing back at the Ten Commandments, because if you look at the Ten Commandments in the Old Testament, you find this idea of love expressed there. The first four commandments really deal with loving God, the nature of our love for God. And the final six commandments deal with the nature of our love for others, what it looks like to love others. So love is the most important character trait of the follower of Jesus. Well, the second thing I want to look at today is the nature of love. You see, love in its purest expression is not something that is received, but something that is given. God is love, not because he is the one who is most loved, but because he's the one who is the most loving. He's the source of all love. God is love. It defines him. If we look again at that passage in 1 John 4:19, we see that we love because he first loved us. He's the source. He's the beginning. It comes from him. And our ability to love is all related to God's love for us. You know, if you or I just go around looking for love, we will never be filled up. Our need for love is insatiable. It's infinite. It's a bottomless cup. It can never be filled. We're so thirsty for love. Our desire and our need for love is so great that we will only consume and devour others in our quest for love. If we're disappointed long enough, we become disillusioned with love. We become convinced that no one actually loves us, or perhaps that we are unlovable. You see, love needs to be given away. And unless we're giving away more love than we're receiving, then we'll never really experience love. Remember that passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the love passage? Paul writes a beautiful treatise on love, and in the midst of it, he says that love is not self-seeking or selfish. It's always about the good of others. Love always puts others ahead of itself. And if you're feeling unloved today, it just might be that you've been focused on receiving love rather than on giving love. You see, when your focus is on giving love, you open yourself up to receiving love, to feeling loved yourself. As long as your focus is on meeting your own need, on filling yourself with love, then you have no capacity to really receive it. It just flows right through you and leaves you feeling empty. When you or I are committed to loving God first and then focusing on loving others out of that connection we have with God and that endless supply of love we receive from God, then we will find that love will pursue us and it will find us. You will be loved. The Bible promises that. God desires that you and I literally generate love. That we're to be love machines. I'm not going to sing that song for you. There's so many passages that teach that, but I'm thinking specifically of 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 in verse 12. It's perhaps the most straightforward. It says, "May the Lord make your love for one another and for all people grow and overflow, just as our love for you overflows." Grow and overflow. It's supposed to be expanding in capacity to become self-generating. You see, as you give love away, it allows more love to come. You know, there's something about being a giver that leaves you feeling whole. It leaves you feeling complete. We talked about that when we were talking about generosity, that when your focus is on giving away, then you feel rich, and it's true of love. When you're giving away love, you find that there's an endless supply, that there is always enough. And as you give that love away, well, then there's no limit to the love that we can receive ourselves. Think of a pond that's only receiving. It's only receiving water into it. It becomes stagnant and stale, and algae grows. The Dead Sea is an excellent example of this. It becomes salty and worthless. But when there's an outlet for that water, when there's a way for it to go out and water and enrich the land around it, well then, that water stays fresh and brilliant and bright and clear. We are to be like that pool of water, to have more outlets than we have input, because when we do, the supply coming in will always be fresh and clear. We're to generate love. And finally, I want to look at the need for God's love. You know, every single one of us need unconditional acceptance. We need forgiveness. We need the compassion of others. And yet, every source of love that we encounter and experience in life ends up being insufficient for our needs. Humans have or will fail us every single time. Whether it's a marriage relationship in which you find that your spouse just doesn't measure up, their capacity to give you the love you need just doesn't ever match up with your need to receive it. Or whether perhaps it was your parents as you were growing up and you just felt that their love wasn't sufficient, their love failed you. Every single human being will fail you in terms of giving you the love that you need, because the need you have is too great for any human to meet. What we have not received from others, we can experience in a relationship with God. Every good and precious thing that we really need is found in an unending, unconditional love of God. All that our souls long for can be satisfied in a relationship with Jesus Christ. In Jesus, you can receive a love far greater than that which others have deprived you of. If you've been disappointed by the love of others, if there's someone in your life right now who has let you down, who has failed to love you as you feel you deserve to be loved, know that you need to seek Jesus, that you need to discover the love that God has for you in Jesus, and only then will your soul's desire for love be satisfied. You know, families can be the toughest place to find what is supposed to be there. It sometimes seems that we're the best at hurting those that we're supposed to love the dearest. How often do we wish those in our family would love us better? You know, we suffer from disappointment when we do not receive from others what only God has the capacity to give us, unconditional love. And if we're honest, we realize that our expectations of others are too high, because even we are incapable of giving love unconditionally. Only God's love is offered without condition. Only God's love through Jesus Christ can make us whole. And we can only have a great capacity to love others when we first trusted God with our hearts and accepted the love that He has for us. When you and I grasp how wide and long and high and deep the love of Jesus Christ is for us, then we will be filled to overflowing with a sense of the goodness of God. And only then can we overflow, can we begin to love others with a measure of uncondition, the ability to love extravagantly. Have you ever loved with all that you are? Is it possible that it's not God that needs our love, but we who need to give all of ourselves to God? I'm not sure that I yet fully understand what it means to love God with all my heart and soul and strength. It's my desire, but I'm cautious. I'm weak. I'm half-hearted and I'm double-minded. But I do believe that God has invited me, and God invites you, to give all of ourselves to Him, to trust Him with everything, to trust Him with our hearts, to take our heart, that which we hold most dear, that which we desperately want to be loved, and give it to Him, to trust Him with it, because God can be trusted. God will not fail us. God will not abandon us. God will always stay with us. God invites me to demonstrate faith, by giving what love I do have away to others, to my spouse, to my kids, to my church family. And only as I trust him, by giving away what I have, do I discover a capacity to fully experience what it means to truly be loved. It's amazing how really this is so much like the generosity that we were talking about a few weeks ago. That we give our tithe or offering to the church, not because the church needs it, but because when we give, when we act in faith, when we put what we have out there, we're opening our hands to receiving what God has for us. And when we desperately cling to and hold on to and keep for ourselves and don't share, it keeps us from being able to accept anything else. And love is like that. We were designed to live this way, to be expressions of the goodness of God and channels of his love and blessing in the lives of other people. You and I were designed to generate love, to be light in the darkness. If you've been measuring love, if you've been weighing it in the balance, evaluating whether or not you're getting your fair share, then you have been and will continue to be disappointed. Can I encourage you today to take your eyes off what you think you need? Take your eyes off of receiving and instead look for opportunities to give. Give yourself away. Give love freely. You see, the more that you can give love with no strings attached, the more you discover the love of God for you, with no strings attached. If you seek to love God fully, if you let his love for you be an unlimited supply of love that overflows out of you and into the lives of others, then you will discover a love beyond measure, a love like you've never experienced before. My friend, all that you are looking for can only be found in a relationship with God. May your soul find rest in God alone. And may you love others without measure. Will you pray with me? Our loving God, oh, how we need your love. Oh, how we know that only you are sufficient to meet the needs of our lives, to make us whole. God, we want to know you. We want to love you with all of our heart and soul, our strength and our mind. Forgive us for holding back, for not trusting you completely with our hearts. Forgive us for holding others to a higher standard than we hold ourselves to. Our Heavenly Father, this morning we confess that we're not terribly great at love, but we desire to be. And so will you help us today and in the weeks and months ahead to look for opportunities to give love away, to love others as an expression of our love for you. And we'll leave our own needs up to you. Meet them as only you are able. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's close with a final song.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all.
Love God, love others.